Divine Rank 6, Utgard the Barbarian God. Utgard is the god of the Utgard Barbarians that dot the northwest side of Faerûn. They cover the northern side of the Sword Coast and can be found anywhere on this map. He's also the god of physical strength. Being Divine Rank 6 means that Utgard is basically on the cusp of becoming a demigod. That is because Divine Rank 6 is the lowest you can be as a lesser deity. This, of course, has to do with Utgard's issues losing a lot of his devoted thanks to a lot of his barbarians switching to Tyr and Torm, or sometimes even to Aurel. First, let's start with the juicy stuff. Let's talk about the stats of a god. What can this guy do? First and foremost, keep in mind that the stats that I'm about to give you are 3rd edition stats. Now, what does that mean? That means that the plus 2 hit values will be very different from what you're used to, and the armor class will also be way higher than what would make sense for 5th edition. In 3rd edition, your character could obtain a plus 20 to their attack, or much, much more, really easily. Enemies could have up to 30 or even 40 AC. Because of that, we won't talk about how much AC these gods actually have or what their attack values are, because it just doesn't translate very well. But everything else should be perfectly translatable, however, which makes this very, very fun. Uthgar, total level 40, with 20 levels in Barbarian and 20 levels in Ranger. 40 Strength, 24 Dexterity, 37 Constitution, 24 Intelligence, 24 Wisdom, and 27 Charisma. To put it into perspective, the highest stat that I have seen in a god is 50. While Cronus, one of the most powerful monsters in the entirety of Dungeons & Dragons, what they call basically the God Killer, has a strength of about 69. So hopefully that gives you something that you can compare it to. Now, Utgard has over 960 health, though keep in mind that in 3rd edition, health was generally lower than 5th edition standards, just not by much. So you should probably assume that he actually has a bit more than that. He wields the axe called Foe Striker, which functions similar to a Dwarven Thrower, where he can throw it like a boomerang and have it come back to him. Its greatest strength is his ability to kill giants. The axe Foe Striker deals triple damage to giants and giant kin. Now, being a lesser deity, he can choose to take a 10 on any roll on any check, and natural ones do nothing against him or to him. Further, he can see, hear, and smell at a distance of 6 miles, and as an action, he can perceive anything within 6 miles of any of his worshippers, holy sites, objects, or any location where one of his titles or name was spoken in the last hour. He can also extend these senses to up to 5 different locations at the same time. He can sense any threat or attack directed at the Utgard Barbarian tribes as long as that event affects at least 500 people. And because he also has physical strength in his portfolio, he also is divinely aware of any feat of great physical strength in Faerûn, if that event, again, affects 500 or more people. Lastly, he can create any magic item as long as that item includes a piece taken from an animal that serves as one of his beast totems. Otherwise, he can create magic weapons and armor only as long as the market price for that item does not exceed 30,000 gold pieces. Utgard rides what he calls a sky pony, really just a powerful Pegasus, who has great abilities of detection. He also has a ton of abilities that relate to his divinity, as you can see here. It's hard to tell how exactly all of this translates to 5th edition, though just know that in general, not for everything, but in general, enemies in 3rd edition dealt less damage than in 5th edition. Now, gods can basically cast any spell they want. Spell slots and prepared spells and the like are not really a true limiting factor for them at all. Instead, the way they work is they are empowered when using spells and abilities that relate to their portfolio. For example, Utgard spells deal more damage and are harder to resist if they are chaotic spells. He also refuses to cast darkness-related spells and evil necromantic spells, specifically those that have to do with undeath. Utgard does not cast secular magics either. Wizard spells are for the weak, and he also very much dislikes resurrection. He's not the type of god that will simply freely give you resurrection spells to clerics. He needs convincing before he grants you that power. Lastly, keep in mind that as a barbarian god, he also has a very powerful divine rage that makes him very, very strong. Now, that being said, those are the stats. Keep in mind that unlike many other gods, Utgard does not really show himself in the world much. Only two instances have ever been recorded of his avatar showing up in Faerun, and for the most part, he doesn't communicate very much with his followers either. Instead, most of the talking and communion happen through his spirit beasts. But for that, we need to discuss the god a little bit. Let's go ahead and talk about Utgard. Before that though, this video is brought to you by Grimhollow, the campaign guide. If you're looking to play or DM in a dark campaign setting, then this is the book for you. As you can imagine, of course, as a setting book, it has this detailed world with kingdoms and free cities, locations, factions. The whole map, as you can see it here, it's all very well described so that you can get in there and experience the dark world of Aetheris. Now, this is the type of world where you will have to deal with werewolves and vampires, ghosts and specters, inquisitors, you know, burning witches in towns. A lot of people like that vibe, and this book brings it to you. As you all know, playing in a dark, grim campaign is really all about atmosphere, and the art from this book really sells the setting. It's some of the most evocative art that I have seen in a setting book in a while. However, the most important thing that this book provides that I think is really its strength is its ability to actually help you play the setting better. So even if you already have your own dark world, this book can really help you bring that vibe to life. They have a whole chapter dedicated to running a dark fantasy campaign where they teach you how to bring that vibe into the table. They have cursed monsters, they have guides on how to build legendary dark monsters, they have three adventures in the book that are set around dark fables with great art for you to use, they have dark flavored feats, they have five pages dedicated to awesome special curses. They also have character transformations into monsters. I mean, they literally have it all. Even if you are already running Barovia or any other dark setting, I would honestly recommend checking out this book and adding all of these features to make it just run better. If you're not using Grimhollow's curses or transformations, you're honestly doing a disservice to the genre. Grimhollow, the campaign guide. Go ahead and check out the store. The link is in the description below. But now, let's enjoy some Utgard. Utgard, when he was a human, used to be a thane from Ruathim. His name was Utgard Gardulfsson, son of Gardulf Beruna, for whom the Beruna Mound is named after. Utgard, like many Northlanders before him, used to raid and pillage coastal cities in the Sword Coast. In fact, he even conquered ancient Ilusk back in the olden days. For those of you who don't know, Luskan is a city sort of built on top of an ancient and very powerful city who used to be sort of like the seat of an ancient great empire that resided here. Well, Utgard attacked them from the sea and actually conquered them. Instead of just pillaging them, however, and leaving, he expected to rule over them, but the people revolted and burned his ships, forcing Utgard and his armies to stay in the mainland rather than coming back into his own islands. This started the process of Utgard systematically just sort of conquering the Sword Coast now that he was forced to live in the mainland, making a mark for himself as a form of barbarian emperor. All of this happened, by the way, around 1500 years ago, as to the events of 5th edition in current times. Now, during those times, he defeated and absorbed the powers of a bunch of powerful spirit animals. The Black Lion, the Black Raven, the Blue Bear, the Elk, the Grey Wolf, the Great Worm, the Griffin, the Red Tiger, the Sky Pony, the Thunder Beast, the Tree Ghost, the Red Pony, and the Golden Eagle. These were all powerful spirit animals that dwelled in the Sword Coast. He defeated them and absorbed their power, becoming the most powerful barbarian of the Path of the Totem. Eventually, he died after defeating the Great Chieftain of the Frost Giants, a massive one called Gurt. After killing the Frost Giant Chieftain, this happened. Quote, "Blood flowed like spring melt water from Utgard's wounds as he stood before his sons on the massive skull of Gurt, the Lord of the Pale Giants. With a strong voice, he spoke of his gift. Mighty Tempest declares that I may no longer walk among you. I will not go without leaving you a final fight. You know that I have fought the Beast Gods and taken from them a part of their strength, which I in turn give to you. Teach the children these secrets. If they devote themselves to the Beast Gods, then they may call upon the Beast's power." And so, speaking, Utgard mounted his Sky Pony and joined his father Beruna in the war halls of Tempest, end quote. And since then, Utgard has been a close ally of Tempest, since he ended up turning him into a god. After that, the barbarians that followed Utgard separated and each went their own way as they scattered across the land. Each separate group now follows a very specific totem of one of the spirit animal gods that Utgard defeated. So in essence, if you're a barbarian path of the totem, you theoretically are from one of these Utgard barbarian tribes and venerate one of their totem animals. Now of course you can do whatever you want with your story as a player or as a DM, but essentially, yeah, Utgard would be your god if you are one of these barbarians. Now, this particular story is very important if you play or DM Storm King's Thunder, as the Utgard barbarians do play an important role in that story. In fact, the weapon that Harshnag the Grim, the legendary member of the Grey Hands from Waterdeep, a frost giant adventurer, wields is from this story. He wields Gurd's Greataxe, an axe that killed the mortal form of Utgar. This is why if any Utgar barbarians see you or Harshnag with that axe, they will attack you immediately. Now, it is important to distinguish Utgar barbarians from Northlanders. I can see a lot of people making these errors, especially when playing an adventure like Rime of the Frost Maiden or Storm King's Thunder. See, Northlanders are the stereotypical Vikings who mostly live in the islands to the west of the Sword Coast, just out there in the sea, or far in the north around 10 towns. They are all blonde, which is one of the main distinguishing features. Utgard barbarians are descendants from those barbarians, so you will see, of course, a lot of similarities, but the main visual difference is that the Utgard barbarians tend to be black-haired with blue eyes. They are not blonde. Utgard barbarians also have a particular hatred of wizardry and really any type of magic that is not divine magic. Now, it can be particularly confusing because there is a branch of Northlander called the Ragged Barbarians that specifically live in Icewind Dale, and those barbarians are also separated into animal tribes. They have, for example, the tribe of the bear and the tribe of the elk. So it is very tricky, I know, but they are very, very different. Like I said, these differences are important if you play an adventure like Rime of the Frost Maiden. Now, normally this would be the time when we would start talking about the clerics of the god, like their costumes, their mannerisms, their special abilities, and of course any holy days, but this god is particularly special. He's special because instead of just having clergy, he has an entire culture of people that follow him, so let's just go ahead and talk about the people. Each tribe of Utgard barbarians serves an animal totem, though the worship of the totem encompasses more than just merely the animal god. When you pray to the totem, it also involves praying to Utgard, his sons, and his sons' sons, which in turn really directly translates to a prayer to all of your ancestors and all of your previous chieftains. Utgar himself has no personal symbol. Instead, he is venerated directly through the animal gods that he represents. He also has no temples or shrines. Instead, the people of Utgar and the shamans venerate him anywhere through easily carryable totems. This is because the Utgard barbarians are a nomadic tribe. They don't settle down, hence they have no actual shrines. The one exception, of course, are their tribal mounds, which is where they bury their dead, which doubles up as their most holy site. The fact that their entire religion is based on venerating and praying to their ancestors, of course, leads them into considering their graveyards to be their most important holy place. Every Utgard tribe has a holy mound that they call their own, with some exceptions, of course, but these mounds are typically found in hard-to-reach places or relatively well-hidden locations. These mounds are believed to have been created by the first chieftain of their respective tribes, and they believe that the respective animal spirit god is also buried there, and so, of course, as you can imagine, and they defend it to the death. It is in these mounds that the Utgard barbarians gather once a year to perform rites of passage for their males, perform weddings, and commune with Utgard and the animal spirit. This gathering at the respective mound happens during their most holy of days, which is the first day of autumn, also known as the autumnal equinox. Their religion in general is very tied to nature, and hence a lot of their holy rituals happen during the changes of season. Typically, they do a day and night fasting during the seasonal changes. They call it the birthing in spring, the fullness in summer, and the darking in winter. It is at these days that Utgard barbarians are given their vision quest, a quest that can only be given once in a lifetime, a quest given by their spirit animal that, if completed, will grant the person a tremendous boon. The quests are typically very dangerous and extremely difficult to complete, but if completed, the person becomes a legend amongst all the children of Utgard. The Spirit Quest is a level 6 spell cast by the high-ranking shaman of Uthgar. However, the shaman does not actually know the nature of the quest. Sometimes not even the recipient barbarian knows the nature of the quest. Instead, the quest is given to the barbarian through dreams, mystifying visions, or cryptic messages. It is up to the barbarian to interpret the visions and attempt to complete that quest. The barbarian may admit failure during the quest, at which point, well, the Spirit Quest ends and the barbarian receives a loss of status among the tribe. This would be, of course, the main way for an Uthgar barbarian to actually be an adventurer and go out and perform missions. Now, the Spirit Quest and many of these other gatherings happen during the summer, spring, and winter equinoxes. Autumn, however, is special because at the beginning of it is when they go to their holy mound. This they call the Rune Meet. Typically, you will have all of these different groups that belong to the same tribe that live in separate areas. They will bound together in the mound at this day. Any kind of officiation that needs to be done will happen there, including any changes of laws or any type of official business that needs to be decided. And they, of course, also venerate Uthgar and the dead. For the children who are ready to become men, they are given the ritual of the Rune Hunt, in which they gather and seek victory over one of the tribe's enemies. Typically, those will be orcs. And when they come back successful, the shamans will then hold a ceremony known as the Telhut, which initiates them into adulthood. Women, on the other hand, go through a different initiation where shamans of Shantia, goddess of fertility, will initiate them into womanhood. Now, because Uthgar barbarians are nomadic and they travel all over the place, they set up guardians to guard their sacred mounds. These guardians are typically either the ghost of their ancestors or spirits that pertain to the animal god that rests on that mound. And this is typically done through a spell given to shamans by Uthgar called Summon Ancestor, a third-level necromancy spell. They cast this and summon the spirits in order to have them protect the place for the rest of the year while they nomadically travel. Alternatively, these spirits are also summoned by the shaman in order to be asked questions about the tribe's past, to seek guidance, or to ask for favors. And keep in mind that the Uthgar languages does not actually have an alphabet, and so they cannot write or read, and hence, much of their history is oral, and a lot of it is retained through these spirits. On top of all of this, Uthgar shamans also open and maintain portals on top of the mounds. These portals lead into the astral plane, and is essentially a gate for Uthgard's power to sift through into the prime material plane, summoning spirits to defend the mound and honoring the dead and all of the official business they do in the mounds is the reason why the Rune Meet is the most important day and holy event of the Uthgar barbarians every single year. Now, like I described before, each tribe has a different mound that they venerate and protect. They are as follows. The Black Lion tribe prowls the Northern Silver Marches and the Druerwood. They protect their spirit mound at Berun as well. They share this mound with the Red Tiger tribe, who share some of their similar locations of existence, except that they are more aggressive in their raiding of settlements. And the Black Lion tribe typically avoids settlements and only hunts them during harsh winters, but the Red Tiger tribe, on the other hand, attacks settlements very, very often, preying on caravans and boats that pass through the Raven River. The Red Tiger tribe has become more and more bold as of late, making forays even as far south as the High Forest. The Black Raven tribe owns the icy foothills west of Mirabar, as well as the ice lakes and the land west of the Frozen Far. They attack travelers that pass through some of these desolate roads. These guys ride enormous giant ravens, allowing them to pass through the desolate and cold areas of their region. They share their Holy Spirit mount with the Grey Wolf tribe, which is, of course, Raven Rock. The Grey Wolf tribe is a tribe of murderous werewolves. They hunt and roam looking like natural wolves, doing their best to prevent survivors in order to not spread out their lycanthropy to others. Unlike many of the other tribes, however, the Grey Wolf tribe doesn't really have a specific location where they exist and travel from. Instead, they can be found all over the Sword Coast and even farther east. The Blue Bear tribe was previously thought to be extinct, but has recently come back in force. They now claim parts of the High Forest and the Delimbir Vale. They have spread out as far north as the Nether Mountains and as far south as the top of the High Moor. Their spirit mount is called Stone Stand, though they take great efforts to remain hidden as they travel around, trying to preserve the notion that they are actually extinct. The Elk tribe wanders the Evermoors and the lands north of the Disarin River. Their spirit mount is called Flint Rock. Now, this tribe is particularly antisocial. They shun civilization hard, and their tribe leader has spilled so much blood that he no longer craves it, so they can be very difficult to find. The Great Worm Tribe is located around the Great Worm Cavern, where their spirit mound lies, in the spine of the world. They sometimes venture around to find food all around the mountains, the Fell Pass, the Frost Hills, the Lurkwood, and the northern reaches of the Silver Marches. The Griffin Tribe longs to wipe out all of the cities of the north, like Uthgard once did in the past, but in this quest they have made too many enemies and their numbers have dwindled. They are one of the few tribes who have actually built a settlement instead of just being nomadic. The place is called Griffin's Nest in the Cervin Hills, but the place is a guarded encampment, not a trading post as it was in the past. Their spirit mound is called Shining White. The Sky Pony Tribe has their spirit mound in the Moonwood. It's called One Stone. They settle and live around the area. This spirit mound was actually also used by two other tribes of Uthgar barbarians, but unfortunately, those two tribes have now fallen extinct. They were the Red Pony Tribe and the Golden Eagle Tribe. We don't know exactly what happened to those tribes, though based on the area, it is safe to say that it might have had something to do with the incredible numbers of orcs in the area. For those of you who don't know, what is arguably the strongest horde of orcs on the Sword Coast is actually up here in this area of the north. The Thunder Beast Tribe has a spirit mount in the bone-strewn hill called Morgur's Mound. Now, they haven't been seen in a few years because they have been hiding in what appears to be an attempt to prepare themselves for a massive incoming raid that they're planning on doing. Their hope is to come out from the Lurkwood, which is where they are hiding in mass, and stampede through the Cervin Hills and the Deserim Valley, taking everything in their path. Hasn't happened yet, but it will happen soon. And then last but not least, the Tree Ghost Tribe claims the Grandfather Tree as their spirit mound, a grove hidden in the high forest. They consider themselves protector of the grove alongside the native elves of the area who share the grove with them. This particular tribe possesses a fair amount of members from other tribes who have found the fabled Grandfather Tree and have become enlightened by its finding, and then have decided to desert their own tribe to join the Tree Ghost Tribe in defending it. Many other tribes have attempted to in the past to find this mound and claim it for themselves, but of course have failed to do so. See, tribes typically don't fight each other, but they also don't really get along with one another. Since they venerate different spirit animal gods, their personalities and peculiarities make them stand out from one another and makes them want to desire different things. These differences have ironically prevented them from conquering the north, since they are all separated from one another and have no singular goal in mind. Though as you can see, you can virtually find them anywhere within the Sword Coast and the lands to the east. And typically, if you're playing D&D and you encounter wild barbarians from the hills or from the forest, they are probably going to be Uthgar barbarians seeking to raid and plunder you. Now, all of these mounds are roughly similar, as you can see. They're all huge earthen work mounds, typically in the shape of the animal that they are supposed to represent. These mounds, of course, are where the most important members of their tribes are interred. Normal members are typically buried in lesser and smaller mounds that are scattered all throughout the land. The mounds typically have two rings of earth called cairns, which surround the central and larger altar mound. Keep in mind that the Uthgar are very superstitious about them. They both fear and revere them, and the mounds are covered with treasure under the ground, of course, as the chieftains that are buried there are buried with tons and tons of treasure. Uthgar barbarians believe that the remains of Uthgar himself and his brothers are buried in Morgur's Mound, the mound of the Thunder Beast tribe, but the actual holiest of all sites is instead Berun as well, the mound of the Black Lion tribe. That is because that's where Uthgar's father died and was subsequently buried. Now, the last thing I want to cover on this topic has to do with the shaman's holy symbol, what they actually use in order to channel the powers of Uthgar into the world. See, since Uthgar doesn't actually have a symbol per se, instead, the shamans use what they call a sacred bundle. The sacred bundle is a bag, always a bag, and holds spell components, objects too holy for others to see, and a small carved miniature depiction of the shaman's totem animal. Quote, "These objects have been assembled by the shaman at the behest of his ancestral spirits. Each sacred bundle is protected by a guardian spirit who appears from the bag if it is opened by anyone other than its owner." End quote. Now, to finish off the video, let's just talk a little bit about Uthgar and his personality. Quote, "Uthgar is proud, fierce, and independent. He makes few friends and remains uninvolved enough with interfaith and interdeity conflicts that he has accrued few enemies. Uthgar loves a good joke, and his laughter is full and hearty. He enjoys the sensual pleasures of the flesh, even in his divine state, and likes to hunt, eat, drink, and be merry in his feast halls with the warrior spirits he has called to serve him in Utgardheim. He is tireless and methodical tactician, not terribly inspired, but driven to win in the long run. His love for the Utgard people is strong, and he fights against any odds to protect them in the end." End quote. Of course, as you can see, he appears as a tall, burly warrior dressed in only a battle harness, a leather breechcloth, and furred boots. His hair is blonde, long, and worn in a single braid down on his back, and his eyes are a piercing hue of blue. He sports a thick, drooping blonde mustache and has a booming voice. He usually appears riding his giant, dappled gray sky pony called Cloudwing. Now that's it for the video, guys. Thank you so much for watching. Of course, please, please check out the Grim Hollow book. It's a great book. I use a lot of what you can find in there in my adventures. I highly, highly recommend it. Also, if you guys don't know, I'm actually doing a playthrough of Baldur's Gate 3 using my lore play style of gameplay, which is basically just playing through the game and talking a lot about the lore. I have some footage here in the screen so you guys can see it. I basically just go through the game, I talk about the characters, about the gods, everything that I do in my lore videos, I basically talk about on the actual game as I play through it, so you can get an actual, more natural approach to me just talking about the lore and the characters, which I believe some of you might like. You can find that content on Patreon. It is available for every single patron that I have, including the $1 patron, so all you have to do is go in there and support me with $1 and you get access to all of those videos. We have at this moment over 8 or 9 videos that we have done, every single one of them over 40 minutes long, so there's a lot of content in there for you to consume. So I would really appreciate it. Thank you so much for those of you who already are patrons. I love every single one of you. Thank you very much. Now I would like to personally thank my patron supporters, Zach Bowell, Barry Maskand, 5E Magic Shop, Morgan Johnson, Rusty Rain, Biotechnofrag, Daniel Luna, Duck Feeder, Brad Salazar, Terry Culp, The Great Codini, Walker Mott, Omega Scales, Karathas the Bulwark, Zirin King, Ozol, Ariel Nielsen, Alex Cookson, Griffin Pierce, Falky951, Benjamin Bosters, Mr. Salty, Thomas Hunt, Tesla Coil, The Role Playing Junkies Podcast, Prince Daylight Morning Crown, Sabim Kurshap, Solarensis, Ordoric, Nathan McComb, Silent Choppa, Bushido Burrito, AG Dare, Soulless Rider, Roleplay with Advantage, Stalia, Lost Crusader, Tython, Treb909, Olaf Klepp, Tony Arzy, Garrett Minnick, JD Green, Kaser Sky, Famine 52, Georg Footland, Sovereign Mind, and Larian's Folly for supporting me on Patreon at the $25 level. If you would like to support me as well, then please, please, please head on over to patreon.com/MrRex to support. Alright guys, thank you all for being here, thank you for being awesome, it's been a pleasure and a privilege, and I'll see you all next time. Bye-bye.